a God whose greatness is unsearchable. Our brother John would want us to do nothing less this morning than to spend our time extolling his great God, his great King, to the riches of Jesus Christ. So every aspect of our service today will be to that end. We will honor our brother John in that way. And before we begin, I want to give a few words of instruction. If you don't know already, through this wood door here, we have restrooms to the front of our building. So if you follow this sign in, you'll see men and women restrooms. Follow the signs, you'll see there. We ask that if you use the restroom as you enter the building, please keep your mask on. And then we also ask, due to just the season that we're in, we limit access into the building for restroom only until further instruction later in terms of food. Now, John was no passive participant of life. Amen?
Amen.
Even in just the last 3 years that I had the privilege of serving as his pastor, I knew that very well. Our brother John actively engaged in life. And that was especially true on Sunday mornings. John was an active participant in Sunday morning worship. Him and Joanne faithfully sat in the row directly behind me on the middle aisle for John's wheelchair. And as a young preacher, it did my soul really good to hear John's deep-throated singing every Sunday morning. Not always on key, but good singing to Jesus. But it also did my soul even more good, for every time I would get into my sermon and lean into the application, John would give a amen, brother, preach it. And if he got a bit too rowdy, Joanne would lovingly touch his hand, elbow him, and tell him, quiet down, John. John was an active participant in life, because he was an active participant in the grace and the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ. So as we begin our time, I want to remind you this morning that none of us are here to observe this service passively. We're here to honor John's life. For us as believers, we're here to worship Jesus. We're here to extol the greatness of our God, the unsearchable riches of Christ in and through the life of John. But if you're not a believer today and you're here, we want to ask you, we want to remind you to participate today by seeing Christ, by understanding the Savior that was John's assurance, is John's assurance, and is our assurance, the Lord Jesus. So we're going to laugh today. We'll cry today. But we're going to do so, all of it, toward the end of thinking well about the riches of Christ, honoring our brother, John, glorifying our Lord Jesus together. Amen?
Amen.
Let me pray as we begin our time. Heavenly Father, it is with great joy, with unspeakable privilege, I lift my voice to you today. Lord, we thank you for Christ. We thank you for the hope of the gospel. And Lord, because of that, we can thank you for the life of our brother, John Pickering. Lord, we want to remember him well today. Grateful for stories, grateful for his love and affection, grateful for his life. But Lord, we're grateful, I'm grateful, that at the end of his life, we know there is no period, only a comma, leading into eternity because of you. So Lord, we ask that everything today would be to the honor and praise of your great name, that through the preaching, through the reading of your word, through the remembering of stories, through the singing, that we would extol our great God and King, the Lord Jesus. So, Lord, we ask your blessings over our service. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you have your program in front of you, next, Tyler's going to come up and sing one of John's favorite songs, followed by a formal eulogy will be next.
Stan Shipley, and Uncle John was our uncle. Our mom was the youngest of the family, and I'm the oldest of five, and Janice is the youngest.
But he's the baby.
Indeed.
It's an honor to be here and represent my mom's family. So growing up, our trips to California, they were always an adventure. Coming to see Aunt Jo and Uncle John, it meant we got to go to Disneyland, we went to Tijuana, we rode go-karts, and our cousins were always really fun. Susie taught me not to put my elbows on the table. But it's been a great reminder being here the last couple days hanging out with my cousins, because one thing about Pickerings is they love fiercely. And my mom loved fiercely, and my dear Uncle John loved fiercely as well. My middle name is Merle after our grandma, and Uncle John used to call me Janny Merle. And I'll always remember the sound of his voice calling me that. But the way, the amazing love that Uncle John had for people and his family, the way they have just open-armed loved my brother and I and our family, and just the overwhelming love, the non-judgmental love, the accepting love that we grew up with helped me grasp the love of God. And I just want you guys to know I love you dearly, and thank you.
My memories of Uncle John go back to the 1950s. And I didn't know him as John. I knew him as Junior, Uncle Junior. And my first memory of Uncle John was Disneyland. And back in those days, Disneyland was new. I was 4, my little brother Claude was 2. My dad was making movies of us, and Uncle John, under the direction of my mom, was standing near to prevent Claude or I from falling in the water. Uncle John was the only son, and that made him the prince, and Billy corrected me and he said, no, Dad was the king. He had 4 older sisters and 1 younger sister who, like I said, was my mom. And Uncle John called her Bones. She was little, she was skinny. Uncle John was all the time kidding Mom, and I can imagine them in heaven. Now my mom was, our mom was as close to a saint as we knew, and I can imagine Uncle John running into her in heaven and saying, well, I'm surprised you made it. I remember in the 60s the visits from Uncle John, Aunt Jo, and the kids. I remember visiting the naval base. I believe it was in Bremerton. And Uncle John took our family. We had the opportunity to go on the Missouri, the battleship on which Japanese surrendered ending World War II. I remember living in Goldendale. My wife and I were not married very long. We'll be married 49 years in April. But what we got from Uncle John and Aunt Jo was a fruitcake. Always wondered if there was a hidden message there. I remember at Aunt Alma's funeral, seeing Uncle John having trouble with balance and two of his grandsons on either side, tending him and keeping him from falling. 2 years ago, my wife and I, Connie, was able to visit Uncle John, Aunt Joe, TC, and Chris. And we went to lunch together with Uncle John and Aunt Joe. And Connie and I chuckled later as all during that time, Uncle John was flirting with a waitress when she would come. He thought it was cute. Then in January of this year, Uncle John texted my wife Connie and sent his love and appreciation for a picture that Connie had sent to him and Aunt Jo. He stated in his text that he wished we could visit again and stated once more his love for the two of us. It was the last contact that we had with Uncle John. My mom, our mom, was such a person giving to the word, and she instilled an appreciation for God's word in us. And if she were here, she would want all of us to know that the Lord is our shepherd and we shall not want, that he leadeth us into green pastures and beside still waters, and that he restoreth our soul, that he leads us on paths of righteousness for his namesake. Aunt Joe, hear this. And yea, though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we'll fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thou art with me. And he spreads a table before us in the presence of our enemies. He anoints our head with oil so that our cup runneth over. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me, us, all the days of our life, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord. Three characteristics of Jesus in that short six verses. He's our shepherd, he's our guide, he's our host. Thank you for the opportunity for Janice and I to be here and to speak to you. We love our family. We loved Uncle John. And we will see him again.
Brother John went home to be with Jesus, surrounded by members of his loving family, January 27th, 2021. He was born in Port Lavaca. I got that right. Port Lavaca, Texas. To John and Etta Pickering, he proudly served his country in the U.S. Navy for 21 years as an instrument repairman, retiring in 1972 with the rank of Chief Petty Officer, which he told me often. John loved all things automotive, and he owned and operated Pickering's Family Auto in Lemon Grove from 1972 to 2017. He was a longtime member of now the Hill Church, formerly Windsor Hills Community Church. John is survived by his wife of 60 years, Joanne Pickering, whom we love dearly. Children John W. Pickering, married to Peggy, and John R. Pickering, Sandy, and Teresa, married to Chris, and Susan Pickering and Jocelyn Gay. He had 13 grandchildren, 25 great-grandchildren, and 4 great-great-grandchildren. And I want to go back to Psalm 145, and I want to pick up in verse 4. We read these words. One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty acts. On the glorious splendor of your majesty and on your wondrous works I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud of your righteousness. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. The psalmist commends the people of God. He exhorts us to commend the works of God, which is really tied up with this notion of remembering. It's a necessary thing to spend time reflecting and remembering the wondrous works of God, because they speak of the abundant goodness of his grace towards us in Christ. So now we're going to transition to doing just that. We're going to spend some time remembering, as we already have, but remembering the grace of God in Brother Pickering's life through two figures that have played key roles in his life. One first will be John Playball, who mentored John through some years of his life and loved John dearly and is grateful to be able to speak today. And then Pastor Sam Calhoun will follow him, who was the pastor of Windsor Hills, sterile pastors here alongside with me, and served as John's shepherd for 18 years. So brothers, we're grateful to hear from both of you.
Thank you, Pastor Jimmy. And my name's John Claybaugh, and my wife Joyce and I were blessed to be members here back when it was Windsor Hills Community Church for about 3.5 years until July of 2014, which was when we answered God's call to move to a new mission and a new mission field in Olympia, Washington. And that's where we live to this day. If you remember, when I was here before, I was always got emotional when I talked about the Lord. And so I just want to warn you. My wife even gave me a Kleenex to bring up here with me. As I was sitting there, Pastor Sam was showing me his notes that he had about John. And I told him, that's what I was going to talk about. So I'm glad that I'm here first. So Sam's message might be a little shorter. I first met John on the first Sunday that Joyce and I visited here. John came up to me after the service, introduced himself, and welcomed my wife and I. And then we came every Sunday after that, and every Sunday John was always there afterwards to tell us how happy he was that we were still there and that he loved seeing us. Another thing he made sure to tell us about was how much he loved Jesus. And he was just such a nice guy, and he was genuinely interested in our lives and in what we were doing. He also talked a lot about his family and his love for them and how much God had done for them throughout the years. And John was very humble, which is good because humility is very important to God. After having been at Windsor Hills for about a year, we started a men's ministry. It had been quite a few years since they had had a men's ministry here. And we started a weekly men's group that met on Wednesday evenings, and John was one of the first members of that group. And it was here that I got to know John much better. The men in that group, in the men's group, we learned many lessons from John. Lesson number one, John loved Jesus. John's love for Jesus was exciting and infectious. And this seemed to rub off on the rest of us. It was always great to hear John's hearty amen whenever Sam spoke and the encouraging words that he would shout out to him. And it's great to hear that he still was doing that for Pastor Jimmy. John also encouraged all of us in the men's group, and he prayed for us. Lesson number two, John was a rock. John suffered a great deal from his physical ailments. And to compound this, John was a terrible patient. He was always going where he shouldn't go, not taking his walker or his cane, and he was falling down all the time. And I always tried to get him to remember his walker and his cane, but he just laughed and went on his way. But John rarely let his hurts keep him away from the men's group or from church. He was dedicated to his Lord, to his church, to his family, and to us in the men's group. Lesson number three, John was a fun guy. John had a great sense of humor and was genuinely a fun guy. He was always ribbing us and would go above and beyond to get a laugh out of us. I remember one Wednesday evening when he showed up fashionably late to the group with a mohawk haircut at the age of 80. We got a lot of laughs out of that. But John didn't take offense at our laughing. He was pleased with himself for bringing us so much laughter, even if it was at his own expense. John had to live with that haircut for months. Lesson number five was John loved large. Each of us in the men's group knew that John loved us. He told us, and he showed us all of the time. We all as a group learned this lesson well from John. There was a time when we went to a three-day men's conference up at the Pine Valley Bible Camp. And at this time, John's condition had worsened and he had a lot more trouble getting around. And to make matters worse, the camp was in the mountains. So there were plenty of hills, loose dirt, rocks, and uneven footing. I will never forget. How all of the men responded to John. They all helped John any way they could. They held his hand to help steady him when we stood. They put their arms around him and helped him walk with us from place to place. We all worked to make sure that John was able to go everywhere that we went and not be left out of anything. We took turns standing in line at the cafeteria in order to bring John whatever he wanted for his meal. It was truly a beautiful time. It was hands-on love. Lesson number four was John was a vital octogenarian. Every one of us in the group marveled at his vitality and fruitful life that John lived. John never slowed down in his faith. He was full throttle for Jesus all of the time. John inspired us all to up our faith. It was encouraging for us to learn that none of us need to fade in our later years because John didn't. In our men's group, we went through a study about biblical manhood called 33 the Series. This was a very impactful and comprehensive study for all of us, and John was no exception. The second volume of the study is entitled The Man and His Story. We were all raised differently and had different pasts, Some of us had abusive fathers, or absent fathers, or over-involved mothers. We had wounds from our past. This study taught us that we cannot reach our full potential or our future that God had for us if we didn't deal with the past. This study dredged up many wounds in the group, even for John. It was at this time that John asked me if we could get together one-on-one. We met together about twice a month over lunch or dinner for a number of months. John had a lot in his past that he was not proud of, as we all do. Things that still haunted him, things that kept him awake at night. He knew that God had forgiven him, but he still experienced anxiety. John would tell me about some events from his past with tears in his eyes. Myself, I also was carrying wounds from the past. Wounds from an abusive father. But I thought at the time that I was doing well and had everything under control. But through the study, I realized that I had some work to do regarding my past as well. John and I bore our souls to each other, not 90%. Or even 95%, but 100%. We shared our pains and the effect that they had on our lives and on others. We encouraged each other. We prayed for each other. God's healing and restoration began for both of us. In James 5:16, it says, "Therefore, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed." This is God's plan for our healing. My favorite Christian artist is Matthew West. I really identify with most of the songs that he has released, and his newest song is about this very thing. And as a tribute to John, I would like to close by reciting the lyrics of this song. The title is Truth Be Told. Lie number one, you're supposed to have it all together. And when they ask how you're doing, just smile and say, never better. Lie number two, everybody's life is perfect except yours. So keep your messes and wounds and your secrets safe with you behind closed doors. Truth be told, the truth is rarely told. I say I'm fine, yeah I'm fine, oh I'm fine, hey I'm fine, but I'm not. I'm broken. And when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not, and you know it. I don't know why it is so hard to admit it when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall. There's no sin you don't already know, so let the truth be told. There's a sign on the door that says, come as you are, but I doubt it. Because if we lived like it was true, every Sunday morning pew would be crowded. But didn't you say the church should look more like a hospital, a safe place for the sick, the sinners, and the scarred, and the prodigals like me? Well, truth be told, the truth is rarely told. Am I the only one that says, I'm fine, yeah, I'm fine, hey, I'm fine, but I'm not, I'm broken. And when it's out of control, I say it's under control, but it's not, and you know it. I don't know why it's so hard to admit it when being honest is the only way to fix it. There's no failure, no fall, there's no sin you don't already know. So let the truth be told. Can I really stand here unashamed, knowing that your love for me won't change? Oh God, if that's really true, then let the truth be told. Thank you.
Diddle. Thank you, John. Thank you so much. That was, you loved him and he loved you. It meant a lot to John. It meant a lot to me. You said that John was humbled. I got thinking. I one time was a Navy chaplain, and I knew chief petty officers. For a chief petty officer to be humble, that's a real sign of the grace of God in an individual's life. Yeah. Yep. Well, a lot of what has been said by my dear brother John Claybaugh, I will repeat, because this was John Pickering. He was a faithful supporter of the ministry of his church. You could say that every time those church doors were open, you could see John and Joanne walking through. Then you could see John and Joanne with John walking through with a cane. Then you could see him walking through with a walker, then with a wheelchair, but it still didn't stop John from coming and having fellowship with his church family, listening to the gospel being preached. Every time the doors were open, John was there. I doubt if he ever missed a men's Bible study night on a Wednesday. I knew before we had the men's Bible study on a Wednesday, we had a Wednesday night service, you could always know that John and Joanne would be there. That tells you something about a person. That tells you about not only his love for Christ, but his love for Christ's family. And that was John Claybaugh for sure. He loved the fellowships of the saints. He loved a good sermon. He loved the Word of God. He loved listening to God's Word being preached. And I have to say again, Jimmy, so many times I was encouraged by the same amen, preach it, brother. It was just came out of him. It just came out of him. Sometimes at the right time, and sometimes it was still amen, brother, you know. So anyway, he was good. I was going to share a humorous side of John walking in, but then John Claybaugh stole it. You never knew what his haircut would be like when he walked through the door. Would he have a beard? Would he have a goatee? Or would he be clean shaven? It was kind of the variety of the week. And I do remember the Mohawk. And I do remember looking down thinking, what am I going to say next? Yeah. But that was John. That was John's love of life. That was John being a normal Christian man. You know, I like men like that. I like men that are honest. I like men that are open. And that was John. Certainly was him. Yeah, he was faithful to the men's group. And I do remember that retreat. And I do remember the men loving John and carrying him from place to place and holding him up as we walked down that rocky area to the dining hall or to the chapel. I remember seeing him in the coffee shop with the rest of us. It's great, great to sit around a table and have coffee with John. Yeah, that was him. Well, there's one thing that is for sure about John. He's not dead. He's probably more alive today than he's ever been in his life. You see, John knows today the very words that Paul tried to teach us, absent from the body, present with the Lord. John knows that as a reality in his life today. He understands clearly what Paul meant when he said that we will be clothed in the righteousness of Christ. You see, we struggle with issues here on this earth. And that's why we need each other. That's why we have the church. You've got to remember, church, or you've got to understand, we're not perfect people. But that's why we gather together for fellowship. That's why we listen to the Word of God. That's why we have fellowship with other believers and one-on-one things like John Claybaugh was talking about. But John understands now the meaning, the righteousness of Christ. He understands the meaning of this mortal, this person who's going to die upon immortality. He understands clearly the meaning of this corruptible person has now put on incorruption. John knows that full well. So I'm not going to say goodbye to John. I'm just going to say goodnight, and I'll see you in the morning. Good night, John. I'll see you in the morning. And we will. And we will. I'm not going to close with a poem or anything like that, or I should have. Most preachers end every sermon with a poem, don't they? But I'm going to end with something else. I noticed John was born February 11th, 1931. This is February 11th, 2021. John would have been 90 today. And he decided he'd rather celebrate his birthday in heaven with Jesus. But we didn't get a chance to sing happy birthday to him. Would you like to do that?
Yeah.
Let's sing happy birthday to him. Would you come over and lead it for it? If I lead it, it will be absolutely terrible.
Amen.
Let's just sing happy birthday to John.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear John. Happy birthday to you.
Good night, John. I'll see you in the morning, brother.
Just a closer walk with thee, granted Jesus is my peace. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. I am weak, but thou art strong. Jesus, keep me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, dear Lord, close to just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. World of toil and snares. If I falter, Lord, who cares? Who with me my burden shares? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Granted, Jesus is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be. resort. Time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely on to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore, and just a closer walk with thee. Grant it, Jesus, is my plea. Daily walking close to thee, let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Oh, let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Amen. Thank you, Tyler. Thank you so much. Well, everyone, I want to take about 10 minutes. It's been a lot of preaching going on. It's good because Jesus was the preacher. You know, he preached and he taught, and there's so much to learn, and we're going to keep learning until we get there with the Lord. And we're going to learn more when we get there, because we don't really know about heaven. We really don't understand what's going to happen any out there. And once we leave this body and go and be with the Lord, but we know it's going to be good. We know it's going to be exciting. We know it's going to be holy. And but I want to say thanks to everybody. And you don't know me, but I'm Chris Chaney. Some call me Pastor Chaney. But I got to meet John. I got to actually do the wedding ceremonies for Teresa and Chris there. And I know Susie real good, and John really good, and Joanne, you know, it's been a blessing to be able to shepherd them a little there. And thank you for all you invested into them. So when they came through my way, they was good to go. You know, just love on them and enjoy them and receive from them as well. And so you've done a great job here at the church, Pastor Calhoun, Pastor Steele. Thank you, John, for investing into John's life there like you did. Discipleship is part of the Great Commission. Amen. And so thank you for that. Just want to thank everyone for giving me the opportunity to be able to come up and be part of this celebration, part of the life of John. It's a privilege and it's a pleasure, and I count it a real honor. John, chief, I was chief of the boat, you know. I understand what that's about, command, listed advisor, and stuff like that. So I think probably that's how John and I connected really good at first, because that's a shipmate, you know, and being a chaplain, you know, and I work with the chaplains a little bit as the command enlisted advisor there on different units. But John's the chief, you know, once the chief, always the chief. You just can't get that out of him. But John was more than that. John was a faithful church member, a faithful husband and father and grandfather. And John loved God. John loved Jesus. John loved the church. Like I said, the church family. He loved his family. And God made John a good man. And you don't see many men like that today growing up. And so learn from what we've heard and treasure it and grab a hold to it. Don't take it lightly. Young people, you know, we don't want to take that lightly. You really need it. That testimony there that John had. And humble man. Real man, that's authentic, you know, transparent. I mean, that's not easy. I had to learn to be transparent, you know, coming from where I came from. But John had that, and the great influence. Let's not talk about John as one who had influence. Influence continue on. Let that great influence continue to flow and move through our lives to be an inspiration or to impact someone else. Don't let it die. It doesn't have to. So thank you so much for that. John had a favorite passage, and I like to read that passage in John, the book of John, the Gospel of John, chapter 14. And actually, I guess that would be considered the text, verse 1 through 4. I might make some comments on 5 or 6, definitely 6. But John loved this passage, and I want to read it to you, say a few words about the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, it's really all about Jesus. I mean, Jesus came here for us. I mean, he emptied out himself. And he made himself of no reputation, took upon the form of a servant, you know, like a slave. He did that for us. He loved the world, mankind so much that he would come and voluntarily come and voluntarily die the death of the cross. That crucifixion was the worst. I mean, I would come with, you know, give me a gas mask or something. But the crucifixion, he decided to come during that time. Wow, what a man, what a God. And he loved us. He loved John, and he came, he died for us. And they buried him, and he rose again for us. And he lives. Jesus lives. And John, as was said, is there with Jesus now. He's, as the Bible says, far better than what he could be here. Far better. He has it far better than we have it. Don't feel sorry for John. Okay? I'm just saying, he's doing all right. And let's read this passage here. And John chapter 14, verse 1 through 4. And says, "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way, you know." So Jesus is speaking. I want you to get the picture of this. And the picture is really beautiful, because in chapter 13, Jesus starts out saying that he knew his time has come to leave the world. When he knew that, he was going to the Father. So here's Jesus, knowing it's his time to leave this world. He's getting ready to be crucified. He understands all that. Betrayed. Judas just went out. And Judas is going to betray him. And he knows this is going to happen. But before Judas go out, he washed their feet. And, you know, I don't know if I could even wash the feet of somebody going to betray me. But he knew it. And he still loved him. And so he showed the servant to love, washing their feet. They had the supper together, and they said he loved them to the end, says there in 13. And so he's telling them a little bit about, "I'm getting ready to go away, and do this in remembrance of me. And I want you to remember me. This is the bread, and this is the juice." And so you got to get this picture of Jesus. It's like John saying, "You know, guys, let me send this text to you and let you know, Stan, and let me let you guys know, Billy, let me just let you know, I'm getting ready to leave, you know, Teresa, you know, I'm getting ready to leave, Joy." And we get sad by that. And so it's a lot of sorrow behind that and sadness. And Jesus has been everything to these apostles. He's been everything to them. And now he's talking about, "I'm leaving, I'm going away." It's like, what are we going to do without you? How are we going to hold a family together? How are we going to keep things together? How are we going to be protected? we just don't know what, you know. And so it's anxiety in these apostles. You know, they end up in the upper room. I mean, I'm just saying, it's a lot of anxiety. It's a lot of sorrow about Jesus leaving. And Jesus comes to them in chapter 14. And he begins with this, let not your heart be troubled. Don't worry. Don't have any anxiety. It's going to be okay. It's going to be all right. And Jesus is saying, you know, I want you to have my peace. He's trying to give peace. And today, God wants everyone here to have peace about John. And he wants us to have peace in this world. And there's no peace without Christ. And here he's talking to those that have believed on him. Those who are really born again. He's talking to these that have received Jesus, who he is as the Messiah, these Jews here. And he's telling them, look, I'm going away, not to leave you, really, but to prepare something for you. And so you got to get the picture of our Lord Jesus caring so much that he said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. So there's a peace in this text that passes all understanding. There's a peace that I'm going to heaven one day. I'm going to be with the Lord Jesus one day. I'm going to see John again. There's a peace in knowing that this is not the end here, and knowing that I'm just passing through. This place is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I just can't feel at home in this world anymore. Some of us that's 60 and over, like me, some of us in our 60s and 70s and 80s, we can feel like, okay, we leaving this place soon. We can feel it in our bodies. It's almost over. We're getting ready to go be with the Lord soon. We're going to be with John soon. Some of you feel that. Some of you know you're knocking at the door. And there's a peace in all of this. And so today, family, friends, church, be at peace about John. And if you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, you really don't have any peace. Get some peace today. Receive Christ today so you can have the peace of God that the world can't even take away. That's why John could come in here and be like he was and do what he did in his condition, because he had the peace of God, which passes all understanding. People can't even understand. How can you be sick? How can you have these pains? How can you be like this and still come to this retreat? And how can you love me when you know all about me? And why are you not judging me like everybody else? Because he's got the peace of God. And so if you're here today and you don't know Jesus as your Savior, you need to put your faith, your trust, let him give you the faith to believe that Jesus came and died for you, and he was buried for us, and he rose again. He's alive. He's alive. And you want us, all of us, to be in heaven one day. And so this passage says that about that and the place that he's going to prepare for us in verse 2. And then number 3 is interesting that he said he's coming again personally. He's not sending the angels. Okay? He's not sending the escort. He's coming back personally. And we talked about that this morning in the clouds. This is not that when you come down to the earth and set his feet on earth. This is in the clouds. Well, where those of us that receive Jesus as our personal Savior, we recognize that we've sinned, we've broken His laws, His rules, and we're not trusting in anything else other than the work that Jesus Christ has done. Those of us going to meet Him in the clouds. Now, some of us going to go on and meet John, because He says He's going to bring those that sleep with Him, those that sleep in Christ, those that are in Christ, not dead, like you said, good night, see you in the morning, you know. They're coming back with Christ in the clouds. Now, some of you that's up in age, and you know, look, you could be 19 here, you could be 17 and think you got a lot more time left. It could be over tomorrow. I mean, we don't know what today holds, tonight holds, tomorrow. You don't even know if you'll make it home safe. We just don't know. God knows. And so this business about Christ, this business about Lord Jesus Christ and being saved and having a home in heaven and having eternal life, everlasting life, is the most important thing you could do. You know, what if he lived here to be 100? Everybody said, oh, she's so wonderful. He lived 125. That's nothing compared to eternity. It's nothing compared to forever and ever and ever and ever and ever and ever and never ending. And so if you're here today, John would want you to get saved if you're not. He would want you to receive Jesus as your personal Savior. And more than that, Jesus wants you to be saved. He wants you to accept him to receive him as a Savior. So there's a personal exclude. And but here's the thing. He told these people because they were saved. They were believers. They were born again. They had received Jesus. And he told them, look, you know the way. He said, you know where I'm going. And you know the way. Well, somebody here this morning might not know the way. And I just want to reiterate what's been said. The way is Jesus. The way is Jesus. Now, the work that Jesus has done, putting our trust in that, not in ourselves, not in our works, not even in the church, which is the body of Christ, but putting it in the head of the church, which is Christ. And so he says this in verse 6, and I didn't read it, but I'll close with this. You've done so good. It's been a long day, and you've done a wonderful job hanging in there. And after those of you that was at the Miramar services there, and then you're here. And, so I don't want to be long, and I respect that. And thank you so much for just tuning in and staying connected. And let me read this verse here, and we'll be closed here. Verse 6. Don't miss verse 6. And those of you that's going to go back and read this verse, this is John's favorite stuff. This is his best, John chapter 14. And you read down to verse 6. Okay? And here's verse 6. Jesus said unto him, because Thomas asked the question, you know, how and where? And Jesus says this, I am the way. Not a way. The way. There's no bunch of ways. Jesus said, I am the way. The way works. The way to heaven. The way to eternal life, everlasting life. The way to forgiveness for all my sins, everything I ever done wrong, getting the guilt and shame away. The way to getting peace. The way to having joy. The way. Jesus said, I am the way. There's no other way. You can try riches. You can try anything you want, but there's no other way. I am the way. Then he says this, the truth, not a truth. And it's not truth is relevant. This is not none of that. Jesus said, listen, I'm not a truth. I'm not one of many truth. I am the truth. Truth. And so everything we read about Jesus, everything we learn about Jesus in that Bible is truth. And he gives us the Holy Spirit of truth, the Spirit of truth. But he's truth. And Jesus is speaking to somebody's heart here this afternoon. And listen, Jesus is the way for you to have joy and peace and everlasting life and to be made right with God, to be made righteous. Be justified like you never done anything wrong. Jesus that way, and Jesus is truth. It's no lie. It's no deceit. It's not like the serpent. He's not deceitful. He's open, transparent. He's real. He's genuine. He's truth. And then he says this, and the life. There's no life without Christ. There's no life. You know what? Some people, I used to survive. I was surviving. I didn't even know how to live till I got saved. Till I got saved in 1984, all I did was trying to survive. Since 1984, I received truth. I received life. And now I get to live. And like the preacher, pastor said, John is not dead because he has life. Now this thing here falls off. This thing goes back to dirt. This thing corrupts. but not the real you in there. Not the real you. Like the preacher said, absent from the body. When, you know, John not in that casket. John not in there. John is with the Lord. This thing's just something that rot and start to stink and get old and corrupt. We try to make it look beautiful and last as long as we could. But the thing is, we want to be with him. So he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And listen how he closed it off. No one, no man, no human, come unto God the Father. You don't get to the Father except by me. So Jesus said, I am the way to God the Father in heaven. I'm the way to heaven. I'm the life. I'm everything, truth. And so to this afternoon, as we close with the beautiful singing, the songs, it's a wonderful service. Thank you for organizing all this, Pastor Steele. And just thank all of you that work hard in the sounds and the ushering and the moving the cars and just it's the food and just everything. Thank you so much. But don't leave this place without Jesus Christ. Because if you do, you're leaving without truth. You're leaving without life. You want to see John again? You're going to have life. Because John is in life. Jesus wants that for all of us. So thank you again so much. I just want to have a moment of silence. John's a wonderful granddaughter, Jocelyn. And I had the privilege to work with Jocelyn as well. She's going to do a song there for us. But before she come and sing this song, I know the program might have said daughter, but that's his granddaughter. Okay? And I just want everybody to bow their heads for a moment. If you don't mind, out of respect for those next to you, just close your eyes and try not to move around. And this is a moment where someone out there might want to recognize that they don't have Jesus as their personal Savior. He's not in their heart. He's not in their life. They've trusted in something else other than Jesus for salvation, for everlasting life. And somebody out there, you know you done wrong. We all done wrong. And the Bible said that there's none righteous, none not one, none good. So all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And somebody today might want to say, you know what? God, Jesus, I've sinned. I've broken your rules. I've broken your laws. And I want to be forgiven for all that. I want to get that guilt and shame off of me. And I know I can't remove it, but Jesus can. And this afternoon, I come to you, Father. I come to you, Jesus, asking you to forgive me of my sins and wrongs that I've done to you. And I come believing that Jesus came to die for the sins of the world and personally my sin. I see it, I understand it, and I want that forgiveness. I believe that Jesus came and died for me. I believe they buried him in the grave, and I believe he rose victoriously from the grave. And so, Lord, I receive you in my heart today as my Lord Jesus, my Savior. Thank you so much. You can just take a moment and you can have that moment with the Lord. And perhaps you will want to come share that with Pastor Steele later, or share that with Pastor Calhoun later, or the family. But that's the most important thing you can do right there. Get that right there, no matter how old you are, how young you are. So Josh, you come on over, Jocelyn, and get in position to do your song. And when she finished, the pastor, Steele, I believe, will come back. And he have a word of prayer and close us out. So let me pray, though, just to put a finishing prayer touch on any decisions or someone in your heart that you're thinking about right now that you would like to have see them saved. Let me close with this little prayer. Then the next voice you'll hear will be Jocelyn singing. Father, Thank you so much for the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the gospel. And Lord, I pray that if someone here don't know Jesus as their personal Savior, I pray this would be the day. This would be the day where they receive Jesus, their Savior. This would be the day that they receive eternal life, everlasting life. This would be the day when they just turn from the world and turn from their ways to your way. Turn from lies to truth. Turn to Jesus Christ today. Bless God the rest of the day. I pray that you be with Jocelyn as she sings, and that we would allow our hearts to listen and be touched by it, and let it mix in with the testimonies and remembrance and the gospel, and preaching of the word. Let it all mix in well together in our hearts, and move us to where you would want us to be, and have us to be what you would want us to be. We love you. We thank you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Jocelyn.
I can hear. take my hand.
Lord, take his hand.
Lord,
as appropriate, we will end where we began. Not with my words, not with any of our words, but with the word of the Lord. The final verse of Psalm 145 says, "The Lord is righteous in all his ways. He's kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desires of those who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked will be destroyed." Listen to what the psalmist says here. "My mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever." Psalmist promises us that he is near to all who call on him. But he qualifies it. Call on him in truth. I think it's been very clear today from Pastor Chris to call on the Lord Jesus, to call on the Lord in truth is to make sure we call on him in two ways. As another great person from old named John said, we are great sinners, but Christ is a great Savior. So as we end today, we are grateful. The life of John, but more than that, we're grateful for the life that John points us to, the Lord Jesus. So we're going to close out our time in prayer, and then we'll have some instructions. The family has provided some food for everyone. We'll give instructions on how we'll do that, but we are going to enjoy the rest of our time this afternoon. Remembering our great God, remembering the life of John, putting the stamp on all of our lives, saying this, can you say today as you leave, I am a great sinner, but Christ is a great Savior. Let's pray. Amen. Father, we say thank you. Lord, we thank you for your wondrous works. We thank you for your mighty deeds. We thank you for the majesty of your great name, the Lord Jesus. And Lord, it is been a joy personally for me to know the Pickering family, to be able to shepherd John, to be able to, after service preaching, him hold my hand, look in my eyes every week and say, I love you, brother, knowing that he means it. And Lord, that little touch of I love you, brother, is a touch that he's touched almost everyone here with. Father, help us to be mature enough, bold enough, serious enough to take that which John has given us and pass us on to others. That we would be as sincere, as genuine, as honest, and as loving as our dear brother John with all around us. So that we would let all see the joy of the Savior that he knew, and for those of us who know Christ, stand in today. Lord, thank you for all who have served today and spoken. We're grateful for their opportunity and what they've provided in giving us a beautiful day to remember John's life, to honor him, but to glorify his Savior. So, Lord, we love you. We thank you. It's in the name of Jesus that everyone says, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So we're going to ask you as we dismiss, if you will kind of stand, and maybe those who can, and spread to the side for a little bit. We're going to bring some round tables out so that we can eat. And then if we give about 5 minutes, once the tables get up, we'll start with family here. If we'll enter the double doors, the food line, and come out this door. Okay. People will serve you inside. Please wear your mask as you go in. There'll be food there. There'll be those who will serve you. Come out, grab a seat at the table. Fellowship, share some stories about John. I know we have many good ones. Remember him as a brother. All right? Thank you for coming. And we're going to now get the table set up. You are dismissed.